So beneath the cerebral cortex, we have deep gray matter. And I want to point out to you that here is our surface. Here's our neocortex, and it's not very thick. You know, you just kind of look at that. There's some, and you know, here it goes around and around, and then, so it's not really thick, 2 or 3 millimeters thick. Deep to this gray matter is some white matter, and we'll talk about that in a separate lecture. But I also want to talk about some of this other gray matter that's deep within the brain. We talked about our caudate and our putamen and our globus pallidus. These are parts of the basal ganglia, okay? So caudate, putamen, and globus pallidus. We talked about these in motor systems, that the basal nuclei or basal ganglia participate in motor behaviors. There's a separate lecture on the diencephalon, which is all things thalamus. In this image, you can see the dorsal thalamus here. Up in this image, we can see part of the hypothalamus here. And so the diencephalon is all things thalamus. And we have a whole separate lecture on that to talk about those areas. What we don't really what is difficult to include in the scope of the current MOOC is there's a whole bunch of stuff in the forebrain. There's deep gray matter in there that is part of the circuitry of your limbic system. We're still trying to figure out what that does. We know a little bit about it in some non-human primates and in some rodents, but bottom line, in humans, it's really difficult to get a grasp on what some of those things do. But for here, I want you to remember that there's the cerebral cortex is on the outside, white matter deep to that, and then we have these deep gray structures, deep gray matter structures within. So what do I want you to know about the neocortex? Well, how many layers are there? And if you think about it, if you ever ran across paleocortex, how many layers would you expect to see in that? Are all of the areas of the cortex the same? And then what are the functions, or what is the function of any of these following areas of the cortex? What's area 4 do? What do areas 3, 2, and 1 as an aggregate do? What's important about area 17? And what's important about areas 41 and 42? Once you have these concepts, you know, nailed down, you're ready for the assessment.